Well, it's, I suppose, it's all set in my hometown, in our hometown of Northampton, but at least these first five short films, of which only three have been seen at the festival today, but these first five films are detailing a kind of dream time, if you like. They're talking about the substrate of fears and desires and dreams and nightmares, which surely underlies any human situation. I mean, the actual reality of our towns and our lives, that's superficial, that's real on a material level. The most important stuff is the often unhealthy stuff that's going on in our heads. So what we're trying to do with these pictures is to kind of chart that uneasy, subconscious, dreamlike territory that exists under every modern urban town. I have sometimes blamed a lot of what I see as disproportionate amount of lame modern cinema. I tend to blame it upon children's cot mobile manufacturers from the 1970s because they have conditioned an entire generation to think, oh, it's moving, oh, it's making a noise, I'm entertained. I think that what film is capable of is so much more than it is being used for at present. I mean, Mitch is probably much more intensely involved with cinema than I am. But I've seen my fair share of films. I'm a citizen of the 20th century, you know, so I do know what the film medium is, but having Mitch along to kind of guide me through some of that territory is immensely useful. The next thing would be the feature film, which is paced completely differently to the five short films in the showpieces cycle. A short film, you can make it as long as you want. You haven't got any time constraints. Whereas with a feature film, it's got to be under 2 hours, or at least that was what we decided.
Yeah.
And to get that amount of story, and it's got to have a completely different pace. It's pretty much got to be continuous. That's what people expect from a feature film. So we'll be doing that. We will hopefully be introducing all of these absolutely irresistible, fascinating characters that you see for about 5 minutes. We'll be telling a complete, satisfying whole story. But at the end of the film, we want people to think, oh God, those characters were fascinating and we only saw them for 5 minutes. I wonder if they're going to do a television series of this.
And we will.
Where we would be able to expand upon all these ideas, all of these characters. And, unlike most television series, we do actually know what the ending is before we start. We're not just making it up as we go along and throwing in bits of bizarre and eye-catching plot lines which we're going to forget about by the next week. Yes, I am talking about Lost, and sort of we have got everything. If we do this television series, we know what the last shot's going to be. We know everything. That's the way to do a story. You have your ending worked out first, if anything. I think that if we do get the chance to do this, I think it should be quite an eye-opener. I suppose that I would have to say, and perhaps Mitch would agree with me here, that the reason why a lot of my work seems dark, it's purely because I'm from Northampton. A lot of it was intended as comedy. You have to remember that my first job after leaving school was at the tannery, the co-op tannery, where the only form of amusement was throwing sheep's testicles at each other. That kind of lightened the atmosphere. It made it a bit more cheerful. So you can see where I've got some of my perhaps problem with being able to identify what is dark and disturbing material. I think that basically darkness is a part of life, just the same as comedy is. just the same as all of these other genres. They're all part of a healthy, normal human life. So you'll probably continue to find all of these elements cropping up in all of my stories, you know. I'm about 6 pages from the end of my gigantic novel, Jerusalem, which is bigger than the Bible and is going to probably be just short of the complete works of Shakespeare. I'm not saying that the fact that it is of an enormous quantity means anything about the quality, but I'm just kind of going to leave that hanging in the air so that everybody else perhaps thinks that. I'm proud of all of my work apart from that superhero stuff that I did that everybody else likes. I don't have any copies of that in the house anymore. I can't stand to look at it. It was just too painful, too many lost friendships. The things that I'm most excited about are always the things that I'm doing right now. So that includes this film, it includes Jerusalem, it includes my other work. The stuff that I'm doing now, I genuinely think is better than anything that I've done before. Because, well, it better be, really, because otherwise I'm deteriorating, aren't I? If you remember, in the 80s, there were tons and tons of headlines just saying, Bam Sock Pow, comics have grown up. And like they hadn't. There were about 3 or 4 halfway decent comic books, and the rest of it was still the same juvenile rubbish that had been produced for the last 40 or 50 years. What the comic boom of the 80s did was grant a license to a lot of people not to have to actually grow up. By calling them graphic novels, which was a term that I hated, because they're not particularly graphic and they're certainly not novels. Usually they're 12 issues of She-Hulk stapled together. That is not a novel. What I think happened was that a lot of people who were just interested in the adventures of Green Lantern, even though they were 35 or 40, having Watchmen gave them a way of saying, oh, look, I'm not emotionally retarded. I'm reading, this is a graphic novel that are for adults. No, it's not. It's the same comics that you've been reading for ages. I would feel happier about it if graphic novel actually meant something more than it does at the moment, which is big, expensive comic. And that's pretty much all it means.